Hello everyone, a very good afternoon. I'm Utsav Shah, I'm the VP of Strategy and Finance at EasyDI, and I have my colleague Devanshu, and we will try and talk about our experience and exposure on the topic go-to-market strategies today. We are focused more on the SMEs or SMBs and the startups. So of course this is a topic which is very broad and of course cannot be covered from all perspectives in an hour or so. But we'll try to cover as much as we can, and we'd like to make it interactive. So please preserve your questions till the end. A very quick introduction, about EasyDI and what we do. So at EasyDI, we are an AI-based company out of Louisville, Kentucky. We are a 500-people company. We help vendors create AI. Which means that we have helped companies create, license, or transform the data into high-quality training data models. We are also very deeply rooted into health tech, and we have products and services around that. We are available on all the major clouds, which is AWS, Azure, and GCP. So the objective for the day, as I mentioned before, it's very difficult to cover the entire gamut in an hour. So what we have done is that we have try to cover the essential frameworks and the important perspectives that needs to go into every good go-to-marketing strategy. We will divide and conquer. So Devanshu, my colleague, will talk about all works and what execution. So I will talk about a few case studies in this difficult COVID-19 times, where people have how companies have innovated into good go-to-market strategies and achieved their desired objectives even after all these hurdles. So I think with those words, I'll hand it over to Devanshu.
Sure. Thanks, Utsav. And it is our pleasure to present our experiences and knowledge. And we would like to thank TAI and iHub Gujarat for the same. So to start with, what is go-to-market? It is something that any organization on the planet would require whenever they launch a new product, a new service offering, or even a new brand. And the framework that you are able to see on your screen, that is a typical go-to-market framework. It should consist of understanding your audience, identifying various channels, and as well as fine-tuning your branding and positioning statement. And the important part is on the right side, which is execution. And as they say, the devil lies in the detail. Can you move to the next slide, Utsav? All right. So with that, let's take a deep dive on in all of these components. First component is segmentation and targeting. So there are various verticals based on which you can segment the market. So you could segment based on the verticals, based on the geography, based on the size. However, the critical part is you should be able to specify the common set of needs. If you are able to segment those common needs, then it is going to do wonders for you. And let me give you an example. So many times I hear that a company is targeting a healthcare vertical. That's good. Then they say that within healthcare, we are targeting insurance segment. That's great. Now that would work only if you have a complete end-to-end solution that caters to the entire insurance ecosystem. However, if there is a person A who within the insurance segment whose needs are not catered by your solution, while there is a person B whose needs are catered through your solution, then this is not the ideal segment, because within the segment, the needs of various people are different. And in contrast, if I take an example of a marketing CRM tool that gives you an ROI, or the need is to have a real-time visibility onto all the activities that you do. So this need spans across healthcare, automotive, and many other verticals, and that is perfectly fine. So the key idea here is to not distract yourself through these dimensions. Yes, these dimensions are an important part for segmentation. However, the key thing is to make sure that whatever segment that you finalize, it is catered to the common set of needs. Next slide, also, please. Right, and why it is important to identify the segment which has a common needs, and this is particularly for startups and small to mid-sized businesses. And so when you are able to deliver on your promise, those people with a common set of needs, they are going to talk to each other, they are going to reference each other. And when they are able to reference each other, you are able to find your initial beachhead segment. This is basically a place where you can now build and expand upon, because you have the credibility now. No company within the startup or SMB side of a market can afford to have money or budget to generate each and every lead. Hence, it is important that this references, this word of mouth, or the chain reaction ultimately steps up, and that is something which is going to be extremely beneficial for the startup or SMB organizations. Next slide, please. So one of the biggest problems that any startup has, and we have felt that in our experience, is to find the initial set of referenceable customers. Now when you pick a beachhead segment, it helps your organization to narrow down your focus and channelize the energy, time, and money into a segment where you have the highest probability to win. And that is what we say as a land and expand strategy. You win the beachhead segment and take that momentum to expand into the adjacent segments. And this is something that I have seen often with startups, is that they try to go too big too fast, and in the end they are contracting on their failures. So it is up to you to decide whether you would like to expand on successes, or would you like to contract on failures. And when we narrow down our focus to identify a segment, in addition to find the common needs, you should also make sure that the pain that those segment or those customers has, is it urgent? Do they have the budget or the money? Is the size good enough to be profitable? Is that segment aligned to the strengths that your organization has? All these are the critical questions that you need to answer before you finalize on segmentation and target the right market. Next slide, please. Yeah, so with that, we'll move on to the next component, which is channels and partnership. And this is again a key part of any go-to-market strategy. So if I had to share one growth hack on this webinar, it would be, if you can identify a strategic partner with companies who are larger than yours, then you can grow like no tomorrow. And you might think that why you need this, because of the narrow focus that we discussed in the last segment. In all likelihood, you will not be able to provide a complete end-to-end solution. And that is where the whole product strategic partnership with the big companies come into play. And then you might think that why the bigger companies would like to partner with you, right? So if you are able to complete bigger companies' value chain by integrating your solution and creating a win-win situation, then they will be more than happy to partner with you. And let me give you an example of Airbnb and Flipboard. So you would have heard about Airbnb in all likelihood. They are a room finding and sharing application company. But its partner, Flipboard, that is something that you might not have heard. So Flipboard is a news aggregator company that allows a customer to flip through the material, much like the social media feed. An Airbnb company teamed up with Flipboard to create experiences which serves and Airbnb users with lifestyle content tailored to their interests. And there are many such examples around of small companies partnering with such big, huge companies and completing their value chain to provide or increasing the value that they in total can provide. So 1 + 1 is 3, something like that. And if you look at the benefits of this partnership, ultimately it is going to help you increase revenue, but the two other benefits are quite crucial. One is it helps you expand reach and the market share. And the third one is the boost in credibility. Now, since you are a small startup or you are into an SMB segment, if you can piggyback on the brand name of those bigger companies, then your name will get so much of credibility that will really help you grow faster. And along with partnership, it is also important that you identify the right innovative channels. So is it the cloud marketplace where you can sell your solution? Is it the resellers or an innovative distributor who you might fit in with a complementary set of solutions? You also need to identify the marketing channels. Will you go the inbound route or an outbound route? Will you have a mix of both? So finding answers to all those questions will give a tremendous boost to your go-to-market strategy and planning. Next slide, please. All right, so the third component is brand and positioning. And this is one of the most powerful tool that you can have. You need to identify that how you would like to represent yourself to the external world. Do you want to be a high premium or an affordable high volume brand? Do you associate yourself to be an Apple or to be an Dell? However, the questions that I mostly hear from the startups is that, and let's say for an example, if I'm a owner of Ram Enterprises, then how will I brand myself? The answer to that question is, it is ultimately about you, the founders and the co-founders, your people, your culture, and the promise that you make with your customers, and how you execute on those promises. Because ultimately, the way you engage with all the customers and the entire ecosystem, it is how they are going to remember you, and it is how you are creating an identity for yourself. So for the startups, this is quite crucial. Next slide, please. Now, think about what actually is a brand. Now, when you think about brand, you would immediately think about an expression of a brand. For example, iconic grill, which is in front of an BMW, or the sound of Harley and Davidson, or let's say customer service of Amazon. All these are powerful expressions of brand, but they start from something deeper, something from a core idea, a concept which we call it as a brand essence. It sits at the center of your brand, and everything that surrounds it, it could be your name, logo, graphics, packaging, anything. They are all the expressions of your brand. And this is where the consistency is important, because wherever the customer touches, he or she should feel the same. And for startups, brand essence fundamentally starts with the founders and with the culture of an organization. So if what you are trying to create as a brand is inconsistent with your culture, it is ultimately going to fall apart. Can you move to the next slide, please? Yeah. So here is the brand essence framework, and it basically helps you answer that how can I find my core brand value? And that there are three components to it. On the left hand side is the promise. So what is the promise that you make to the customer at its most fundamental level? Is it technology? Is it innovation? Is it customer service? If you take an example of Nike, it fundamentally promises the performance of its customer to his or her fullest potential. So you have to identify that one promise that you are going to make to your customers. The next component is the attributes or the pillars that you want to build your brand. And that there are three levels in it. At the bottom is the standard or the cost of entry. It is something which everyone expects you to have. So for example, if I talk about automotive industry, it is about the safety. That is something that anyone is going to expect from you. At the center is the special attributes or those attributes that make you different and better. And if I take an example of Apple phones, it could be about the design, it could be about the touch, it could be about the user experience. However, at the top is that one unique thing that makes you distinctly valuable. Continuing on the same example for Apple phone users, it would be the feeling of a high status or aspirations that has been met. So, with those unique attribute, they have built such a high barrier for themselves that it is quite next to impossible for any smartphone companies to beat them in that attribute. So moving on to the third component, and brand is not only about this conceptual thing, it is more about the emotion, that how people feel when they engage with you. So if they were a person, if you would like to represent their style, how would it be? Do you want it to be friendly? Do you want them to be fun loving? Should it be highly creative? Should it be aggressive, bold, strong? So based on all those answers, you can ultimately find out that how you can build brand and the brand essence. Next slide, please. Right, and your ultimate objective is that it's not about what customers feels about you. If you can make the customer feel about themselves at a bit higher notch, then you have ultimately nailed this thing. And since brand is such a powerful tool, it is going to help you generate revenue, generate more customers, sales, and it is a long-term thing. it is not something that you can develop it within a day or a month or a short time period, but this is something, a tool which is going to give results down the road. Next slide, please. Right. So this is the entire positioning framework, and with respect to the time constraint that we have, I'll not go through in each and every detail. However, what positioning is all about is to identify that what space you want to occupy in your customer's mind, right? And when you feel this framework, each and every word is going to be important, because that way you will be able to find out the differentiators that you want to focus upon. And these differentiators are ultimately going to help you frame your messages and the marketing collaterals. Next slide, please. Right. So now, after identifying the differentiators, the next logical step is to know your buyers inside out. And within B2B or a B2C, there could be many decision makers, right? So this would be different for each and every product. However, the key here to understand is that you need to identify all of these different types of buyer personas. You need to identify what their pain is, what their motivation is, what their lifestyle is, what are the challenges that they face in their life, how their day-to-day life or work goes on. And to give you an example, if we talk about the sales automation tool, then the user would be the sales team who is using that application. However, there could be an influencer who could be their boss, who would nudge their team to buy this sales automation tool. The decision maker could be the C-suite guy or a CFO who is going to give the final approval. The gatekeeper would be someone who is blocking this product to be implemented or approved. And similarly, there could be many different types of buyer personas. And the key here is that once you identify your buyer personas, then using the value matrix, you have to map the pain points with the messages. And I'll just take one example of, let's say, the end user, and continuing on the same example, if you look at the sales team, then the pain point is that they are wasting hours and hours on manual tasks every day. And the value that our product gives is that we can automate most of those things. And the message that we want to send to them is that you can now stop wasting selling time with AI. And so since there are various decision makers and that there are many buyer personas, you have to craft a customized message for each of them, because they have their own pains in their life, they have their own motivations, and hence it is crucial to use this metrics. Next slide, please. And with that, we move to the final component, which is the execution. Now, as soon as you start launching your product, what you need to do is you have to identify your customer journey or the buyer journey, and you can do it in in this type of funnel, and it could have many stages depending on your solution. However, the three key segments or the buyer journey that I would list is, number one is getting your customer from unaware to an aware stage, which we call it as awareness segment. The second is moving your customer from awareness to consideration stage. And the final stage is moving your customer from consideration to making decision kind of a stage. And you can divide your entire funnel in terms of top of the funnel, middle of the funnel, and bottom of the funnel. These are the standard terminologies which is used across industries. And the key here is to, when you have the visibility on various stages, you can exactly pinpoint that that where I am lagging behind or what are my challenges. Is it getting the initial number of leads? So is stage one my problem, or is it the stage five which says that I'm not able to convert the opportunities into my final customers? So this is ultimately going to help you. Next slide, please. Yeah, and when it comes to the execution, there are few keys to success here. You have to qualify early and often. See, since you are from a startup industry or from a SMB market, each and every time, money and effort you pay is very important to you. So let's imagine if there's a customer that comes into our pipeline, and if you spend 3, 6, 9 months, and after 9 months they say that this solution is something that we don't need, or to realize that this was not the right kind of a lead for me, then you have wasted entire 9 months. So it is absolutely important that you qualify early. The market is dynamic. You have to make sure that you look at all those metrics very on a regular basis. Then you can have marketing qualifiers and as well as the sales qualifiers. And there are some standard terminologies based on which you can have those qualifiers, like a MAN Act or BANT, which basically means that you test with the customer. Do they have the money? Do they have the authority to take decisions? Do they have a valid need? Do the company or we have the ability to solve their need? What is the competition and what is the time frame that they want to purchase this solution? So all these qualifiers are going to help you judge whether this is a valid lead and should we put our energy, money and time into this lead. Next slide, please. And finally, the measurement of all the key metrics that you define, that is the ultimate key. Through that, you can measure, you can iterate, and you can optimize, and you can learn along the way that what are the mistakes that we have made and what are the improvements that we want to make in near real time. So always make sure that you have well-defined metrics which you are constantly measuring, and you are optimizing those metrics. Next slide, please. So just to summarize our discussion, we started with identifying a beachhead segment. Once we do that, the next step was to identify channels, finalize your branding and positioning statement. You also develop personas for your audience to understand what their pain points is. Based on that, you map it to the messaging and the marketing documents that you would like to build. The next step would be to create a sales or a marketing funnel with various stages clearly defined. And finally, you measure and optimize that how your go-to-market is going on. You drill down and see what are the improvements that you need to further make. Next slide, please. So today we are living in an unprecedented time. COVID-19 was something that was not expected. However, each and every industry and organization is getting impacted. What it has done is it has changed the client behavior, and it is ultimately going to change how clients want themselves to be served. So for example, if you look at the digital technologies like Zoom, WebEx, or Microsoft Teams. Previous slide, please. Oops, sir. No. Yeah, so all those digital technologies, they got a boost. And now with this experience, even if the lockdown gets over and gradually we reach to our normal stage, this behavior is something which is not going to get eliminated easily. So that is why it is important that you rework your business model, you realign your offerings as per the client behavior. as well as you revisit the problem that you are solving and identify if within this situation can those be served in a better way. Next slide, please. So this is one of the report from the McKinsey. It is recently published, which says that the 96% of the companies has to modify their go-to-market model because of COVID-19. So this just shows the impact that this pandemic has on all the businesses and the go-to-market that they work on. With that, I'll hand it over to Utsav, who will talk about a few case studies.
Hey, thank you, Devanshu. I think looking at the paucity of time, I'll try my level best to cover the case studies as fast as I can. But, you know, a lot of interesting things have been happening in the last month or so. We have been seeing challenging times, but at the same time, we have been seeing interesting times. Facebook announced its biggest hi to the world by buying its way into the India's internet e-commerce industry with a staggering $5.7 billion investment. What it means is that Facebook, now combined with Reliance, is serving close to 400 million active customers, which is greater than the Amazon, Walmart, and the Paytm world. Now, that in itself is, you know, how big the reach we are talking about. And the reason I took this example is, you know, if you want to define scale when you talk about a go-to marketing strategy, there is nothing better than this. They have launched their first pilot. There is now you can, you know, do shopping via the messaging platform, which they call JioMart. There's a WhatsApp number. You can WhatsApp your, you can just say hi and you'll get a link to the order. You choose your things from the store and then it will be delivered gradually. Right now you have to go to the store and pay, but down the line you'll be able to get it delivered at your home by making an electronic payment. One secret on this you know, case study is Facebook through WhatsApp has been trying to, you know, make inroads into the India digital payment industry, which is scheduled to grow at about 200 billion by 2027. But it had been struggling due to, you know, government restrictions and policies. But you know, with this deal happening, you know, they get an indirect entry into the digital payment industry as well, where they are looking to compete with the Paytm of the world. By just buying out this 10%, you know, they have made great inroads. And of course, after this, we have seen a lot of other investments also flowing into Reliance Jio platform. So that is, you know, one of the things that I wanted to highlight is, you know, how good and how fast you can reach, of course, the market if you're partnering, you know, with the right partner. Let's move on to the entertainment industry. And, you know, this is one of the things that each one of us would have, you know, now been accustomed with. Of course, during this lockdown time, you know, we have been spending maybe 20-30% of time on these old OTT platforms. But, you know, this is also one of the models that has now emerged as a winner as compared to the traditional cinema industry. And what it has forced the cinema industry to do is, you know, they are now looking at launching movies, launching different channels on these OTT platforms. During this pandemic, you know, it has caused, of course, cinemas to close for an indefinite period. Now people don't have a choice. So this platform is something which has emerged as a winner. If I talk about the reach of Hotstar, it is now serving approximately 300 million active customers in India. They were very smart in choosing the right methodology of go-to-market, where they secured the streaming rights of the Indian cricket team. And cricket, as you know, is a religion in India. So all they had to do was subscribe to it, and they had the majority of the followers, you know, with them. And, you know, Disney, who brought Fox last year at a staggering 71 billion. Of course, Fox is the one who owned, you know, Hotstar and Star. And so with that acquisition, it was always eyeing India doors. The first step was to collaborate with Jio and provide Hotstar for free. And then, of course, you know, when the time was right and now they have the number of active customers that they need, Disney has now launched Disney Plus Hotstar. And, you know, it is provided at the lowest and the cheapest rate possible. Plus, it scores over Amazon Prime and Netflix over a lot of other features and functionalities. So that's another amazing, you know, example of how companies have been pivoting and changing their go-to-market strategy. The last example, and this is my favorite from favorite one from the world of software, you know, very proud feeling. Zoho is now, of course, you know, entered a $1 million company, but it's a company which stands for just one thing, and their motto is very clear. It says we want to provide the most user-friendly software. Now, in the COVID situation, they were very smart to understand that the work-from-home culture is kind of imbibing, and the companies have several companies have announced that, you know, this culture will continue, and maybe over a period of 3 to 4 years, we may not ever see a company which says that we have 7,000 people or 10,000 people, you know, sitting in a company. So what they did very cleverly is they launched a whole lot of products which are related to office collaboration tools in form of remotely. They launched Zoho Classes, which is a new mobile app that enables the educational and training institutes to serve the students online. They started providing online free online conferencing meetings free for the government authorities. And of course, they had several such initiatives. But the point I'm trying to drive here is that you can see a company who is so big, but still it needs to adopt to the changing times and change its go-to-market strategy and completely concentrate on a very different set of tools and products, which may not be even on their roadmap. So, you know, with that said, I think in the interest of time, I will hand it over to Piyali, but and happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Utsav, and thank you, Devanshu. I think it was a very clear and crisp presentation and a lot of important information and insights. And I think the case studies really added value to, you know, all that Devanshu was explaining. One or two questions that we already have here. One I can pick up, which Anuj has asked. So becoming a fresh entrepreneur has its own set of challenges, one of which is the go-to-market business plan, which often needs to change, as you mentioned. So his question is, can you explain how can someone either fine-tune or perfect this plan? I mean, is it possible even to perfect it ever at any point of time?
I'll take that one. I think that's a great question, but, you know, my answer is, you know, may sound a bit negative. When I say that if you perfect yourself, you know, that's the end of your existence. In today's world, I don't think there is anything like perfection. You know, the examples that, or the case studies that I just talked about, so they are $1 billion companies. You know, they don't have any constraints, if you see. But still, you know, if you look at their go-to-market strategies evolving with time and how they have, you know, kind of aligned with the customer behavior, it all talks about, you know, that agility is the only way to go. You know, I don't know, fortunately or unfortunately, we are in this world of internet where maybe today we are relevant, but tomorrow we may not be. So I think to answer that, I think you have to be agile in your approach.
So I think that continuous evolution is very important. Whatever might be the size of your business, I think we all have to continuously remain very dynamic and adapt to the changing, probably the changing business and the entire world of business.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Okay. Right. So there's another question we have from Shivansh. What is the best time to do partnership with giants? Means what is the checklist we need to follow before going to a big firm so that we don't face any problem?
That's a great question, and that's a very difficult question as well. So, you know, one needs to understand your business, your industry, to answer that very precisely. But I'll give a very generic answer to that. And of course, I'll share our experience as well. You know, as a company, what happened when we tried to, you know, we also consider ourselves still small. But when we tried to partner with the big giants, you know, the first question that comes up is what lies in it for me, right? So I think whenever you are going for a partnership, it's very important to first of all understand your business in and out. what is the value that you are adding to your customers? What is that? What is your value proposition, right? Why is the customer coming to you? It's also very important to realize what are your weaknesses and what are your strengths. Most of the people don't like to accept that, okay, these are the things that, you know, we may not be able to achieve with the size and the strength that we have. I think it's very important to accept it at an early stage and realize that, okay, what are the alternates that are available to you to achieve that? You still want to achieve your goal, but you know, you want to do it in a different way. And every person on this, you know, it's a very good saying which says that every person on this earth is not your customer, right? So you don't try to serve the whole world. At the same time, you don't want to be everything to everyone. So you don't want to become a company, you know, which is a product company as well, which is a service company as well, which deals with kind of 100 verticals and, you know, every other month or so you are launching a product or a service with no idea about, you know, how the market is reacting to it. You are spread so thin. So I think the best way to you know, have a checklist about partnership is, you know, first of all, do a very deep study about, you know, what is your strength and what are your weaknesses? What is your value proposition? And then in the entire, you know, value chain, where are you located? So if you are, you know, a billing company, what is the value that you are adding as a billing company in the entire revenue cycle management space? Then you can essentially, you know, kind of discover that who are the right partners for you and why would they partner with you. The example that Devanshu referred about, you know, Airbnb partnering with a very small company was of course about exclusivity, because that company had agreed that they will exclusively serve for Airbnb. And which means that, you know, Airbnb is rest assured that, you know, the only work that that company needs to do is to promote Airbnb. Now, you can see several such examples. Well, small companies are, you know, taken over by big giants. And you'll see that it's always, you know, the right fit at the right time, right? So you'll see that those companies fit in their value chain somewhere or the other. And they feel that, you know, it does not make sense for them to go and reinvent the wheels. It does not make sense today for me to go ahead and develop a video conferencing platform, because you have a lot of companies who are already doing it and a lot of companies who are about to do it. So, you know, you want to make sure that you have that overall vision and idea about, you know, what the market is demanding, how good your customer is. You know, how are you going to, how will you have an edge when you are dealing or you are entering those negotiations with your partner? The most important thing, you know, and this is very typical of the corporate world, is there has to be, you know, a sense of collaboration when you are entering into a partnership. Any partnership which is not a win-win is not going to last for long. So make sure that, you know, when you are partnering, you remain true to each other in every sense. If that honesty is kind of, you know, betrayed at any point of time, then, you know, you might be in deep trouble. So I think my perspective on a partnership is, you know, you have to be, true to each other in order to succeed and grow with each other. And of course I hand it over to Devanshu. If Devanshu, you want to add anything to that?
Sure. Shivansh, that's a great question. To answer it, there are at least four questions or a checklist that you need to make sure that you get the answers on. Number one, what are the elements of a complete solution or a whole product that is going to involve the other larger companies? Second is, which of these larger companies do you complement in such a way where there is a mutually beneficial win-win scenario? And that is something that Utsav covered quite beautifully. Third part is specifically which areas are complementary, such as, is it the product, is it the distribution, or is it the market positioning? That ultimately is going to lead to a sum which is greater than its parts, like 1+1 is 4 or 3, right? And the last part would be if you can identify which potential partner can help you drive both increased market share, but also helping knock mutual competitors out of the market simultaneously. So these are all the areas which you need to have a brainstorming session within your internal team. And depending on these answers, you can ultimately figure out that who are the best companies, all the giants that you could go after. And when it comes to the best time for a partnership, it could be any time that you see that it is going to help me, not only in the short run, but also in the long term.
Right. Thank you, Devanshu. We have a question from Manasi, very specific to AgriTech. So the question is there any tip for the go-to-market strategy for an AgriTech startup for sales post-COVID?
Okay, I'll take that one. So AgriTech is one area, and if you have heard to all the great people and all the learned people of the industry, especially all the people who are the so-called gurus of the Indian marketing and sales industry, and of course supported by the economy, there's one sector which is going to kind of grow like no tomorrow, which is AgriTech. If you look at the AgriTech today, and this is a market which covers 70% of India. This is the biggest market that we have. This is still the market which has not evolved in terms of AI. You still see a lot of startups coming in. Some of them are solving different problems like soil forecasting. Some are doing it through drones. Some want to make sure that the pest control process is efficient. Some want to make sure that the farmers get the best price. So they are launching an e-commerce module platform. Now there are different problems that different people are solving when it comes to AgriTech. Your question on whether something should change or we should do something different post-COVID, I don't think so. We need to do anything different post-COVID. I think COVID scenario is something which is neutral for all. I don't think that for an AgriTech company, if your problem is something that is a big problem, you have an addressable market, you have identified the issue, people are ready to pay for that issue, I don't think you need to change anything when it comes to post-COVID. The fundamentals of market gap or the fundamentals of go-to-market would not change. Maybe the channels would change, or maybe the way in which you approach those channels would change. But I don't think that when it comes to AgriTech, you need to change, or any other industry, you don't need to change any fundamentals for the time being. I think on the contrary, when you see the markets opening up, you'll see a very big uptick in the demand. If you are in the AgriTech startup world and you are monitoring the activities which even the government is doing on their part, since we are in the committee of Niti Aayog and we are an active member there, we are aware of a lot of initiatives that the government is coming up with on the AgriTech fund. If you are a very fond of a company called Amazon and you are tracking them every day, their VP of strategy was in India last few months to meet the government, and they are eyeing AgriTech in a big way. So make sure that you reach the market before them, because once this giant set in, it's very difficult for the small companies to survive. On the contrary, there is also another thought that if this giant set in and if you help these giants set in, maybe you are a good partner to them. So I think it's a very very good sector to be in, and I don't see why you need to change anything in your approach.
And to add to what just Utsav mentioned, the learning that I have for the agriculture sector, and especially for the AgriTech during this COVID pandemic, is agriculture is a sector which cannot survive solely on the traditional methods, and it desperately needs the intervention of some large scale technologies to resolve various issues within supply chain and which can ultimately boost healthy production and revenue.
Thank you, Devanshu. I'm quickly going to a question by Dr. Ashok Sharma. The biggest challenge that is in front of entrepreneur today is to balance between the various caps he has to wear. Manufacturing head, finance, marketing head, how to balance between the various roles. He is into the business of processed food business, and I'm assuming it is probably in the state of a startup.
Yeah, I think that's a very common problem to have, and it's a good problem to have, if you ask me. Initially, I think every startup entrepreneur has to, you know, wear those multiple hats. And you know, to be very very frank, based on my experience of doing so, since we are a small organization, I too had to kind of wear multiple hats. I am wearing multiple hats. So currently, also, you know, I am managing like the strategy side of things as well as the finance. But I think over a period of time, you will realize that you gain a greater understanding of, you know, the business. You have a greater hold over that. With of course, time and funds coming in, you can always refer to people who are better than you to do that job. But if you have done that job, you know, I think your perspective about your business or your vision would become, you know, very strong day by day. You exactly know the challenges that may come up, and you're always prepared for the same. So I don't think there is, an answer to how we can not do it. But I think on the flip side, I would say that everyone should do it, you know, to begin with.
So, also, there is one good question. It could be the last one, maybe. It's from Aishwarya. How to give the customers the experience of buying in brick and mortar stores where they can check the quality and size of the product using online platforms?
Yeah, so that's an interesting question. And I think the biggest industry which is up and coming in India, and I'm very optimistic about it, is the AR/VR industry. You know, today if you go to a few platforms, and I forget the name of the company which I just, had Googled yesterday, but there's a company where you can go and do online shopping through AR/VR. And what it means is that you can wear a dress and it will tell you whether the dress will fit you or not. You can try your shoes, and it will tell you, you know, what shoe size is good for you. You can also imagine yourself wearing that shoe and, you know, see how you look. Just like, you know, when you go to a physical store and you have a shoe on and a dress on, and you see, you know, how good you are looking, whether it suits you or not, whether it's comfortable or not. So all these problems or all these issues are actually being addressed by AR/VR now. And, you know, that is the reason why everyone is so optimistic about AI taking place in India, and there's so many, opportunities coming up with that. So I think AR/VR, if you can look into AR/VR, I think that should be a solution to your question.
Thank you.